This is Mark Lane.
This is Robert Groden.
This is Dick Russell.
This is Jim Mars.
This is Lisa Pease.
This is Dr. David Mantic.
This is Cyril Weck.
This is Jim DiEugenio.
This is Joan Mellon.
This is Jerry Polakoff.
This is Gary Shaw.
This is Greg Burnham.
This is Gerald McKnight.
This is Sherry Feaster.
This is Dave Ratcliffe.
This is David Talbot.
This is Doug Horn.
This is Walt Brown.
This is David Lifton.
This is Bill Pepper.
This is Richard Belzer.
This is Oliver Stone.
This is Governor Jesse Ventura, and you're listening to Black Op Radio.
Video computers online. Archiving 44K. Initiate sequence.
T-minus 30 seconds.
Server connection confirmed.
T-minus 25 seconds.
Live stream for 220K.
T-minus 20 seconds.
Phone lines are a go.
T-minus 15 seconds.
Satellite uplink verified.
T-minus 10 seconds.
Flight check complete. Satellite uplink verified.
5, 4, 3, 2,
welcome to Black Op Radio, the voice of political conspiracy research. You're listening to Black Op Radio, the show NSA doesn't want you to hear. Now here is your host, Leno Sanic.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another episode of Black Op Radio. This is your host, Leno Sanic, and today we have esteemed guest, Governor Jesse Ventura. Welcome, Governor Ventura.
Thank you. Geez, Len, you gave me more respect than the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals did in my court case. They wrote an entire review, and during the entire review, never, ever referred to me as governor.
Wow.
Can you imagine the disrespect? These are federal judges who are paid by my tax dollars, and I expect them to work in a fair manner, and yet they do an entire brief and never once acknowledge I'm a governor.
What do they call you, the body?
How disrespectful. No, they just, they, Ventura, that's all they refer to
me as. No, I'm making the joke, as if they would call you the body.
I wish they'd have did at least that.
Yeah.
That would have personalized it more than what they did. No, well, it's just complete disrespect.
Well, you have my respect. Now, since you brought it up, can you give me the status of your case here? It's a little confusing.
Well, it's horrible. I won in front of a jury, and the appeals court chose to throw out the jury's verdict and order a new trial. And they did it because the truth came out. It's unbelievable. And let me explain. During the trial, the other side wanted to portray me as the villain. So they made the public, and remember, 33 media conglomerates are part of this trial on the other side now. They entered it during the appeal process. Every major media corporation in America opposes me. And what happened was, during the trial, they were poor-mouthing. They were making the jury think that it was financially strapping the wife and the children of Chris Kyle, who's dead. And that wasn't true at all. They all knew that they had insurance paying for it all, and yet they were. And then the final straw came with the judge, when two people from HarperCollins, the book company, came in and started poor mouthing too, and they were the ones providing the insurance that was paying for everything on the other side, including if I won. And so that the judge then allowed it limited, which it came out to a half a page on a 20-page summary, four questions in an 11-day trial, four questions. And the Court of Appeals overturned it on that because they said it poisoned the jury when they found out that there was insurance involved. The truth. So in other words, the truth is kept out of our courtrooms today and lying is allowed in. They had no problem with the other side, you know, telling the jury that how financially strapped this was making it for them, which was a lie. And yet when the judge ruled and the truth came out, they overturned the case on that. So I have to go back and retry the entire case again.
Yeah, shocking.
unbelievable. So it's clear, you know, I don't support Donald Trump, and I think he made the wrong words when he accused that federal judge of being corrupt because he brought race into it. It has nothing to do with race. Trump made the mistake of bringing race in. We have corrupt federal judges, and I'll tell you why, Len. It's simple. When you have corrupt officials, which Democrats and Republicans are all, they're corrupt. Look at the whole Hillary scandal, the corruption. Look at the corruption on the Republican side. The whole system is based upon corrupt bribery. So when you have corrupt people running the country and corrupt people appoint their corrupt friends to be judges, how are you going to have not corrupt judges? And that's exactly what we have at the federal level. They sit in these white towers. They don't have to answer to nobody. And they're going against a ruling, Len, a court ruling that has stood for 76 years along with the Supreme Court. And when we challenged it, they came back and upheld the overturning it without comment. Now, I'm a former governor. Don't you think they at least owe me the respect to comment on us challenging why they overturned the case? But they couldn't do it, because if you read it, anyone would say, holy smokes, look at this. They're going against their own rules. Because here's the rule. You have to, when the insurance came in, it came in closing arguments, and the Supreme Court and the Eighth Circuit have both said that they must object then. Well, they did not. It was closing arguments ended at 11:58, and at 12:02, after the jury was dismissed, that's when they objected to the insurance. And the rules state that you can't do that. It has to be done in front of the jury so that the judge has an opportunity to rule on it. And yet the appeals court is just throwing out their own rule on this. And going along with, even though the objection, so there was no objection to what, so they took it upon themselves to order a new trial over something that was not even objected to in the original trial.
Yeah, sounds like a fix was in.
Well, it's a corrupt federal court system, and when Donald Trump states we have corrupt judges, he's exactly correct. And their ethnicity means nothing. You don't need to say whether they're black, white, Hispanic, Asian, or whatever. They're judges, and they are corrupt.
Yeah, now when I spoke to you last time, you talked to me a little bit about this conglomerates that were against you. You mentioned 30. I tried to contact your lawyers, law firm, and I didn't get any calls returned. And I imagine maybe they just didn't want to talk about it during the trial it was on.
Yeah, but generally they don't. In fact, they've now just given me permission last week to go ahead. I've been silent too. I've been playing by the rules. I've been playing the way you're supposed to as a good citizen, allow the courts to do their job. But when you see the courts break their own rules of 76 years and then won't even respond to why they broke the rule, they won't even give us an explanation. They just ruled nope without comment. New trial. So, but actually, Len, actually, though, This is a double-edged sword of good for me. You want to know why?
Okay, go ahead.
Well, now I get a chance to prove two times in front of a jury that Chris Kyle's a liar. So I think with a second trial, there'll be no doubt in the United States of America that Chris Kyle's a liar, because I'll win again because I have the truth on my side. The only way they can beat me is if they bring in David Copperfield, you know, who can create something that didn't exist. Because the altercation Kyle wrote about never happened. There's not one witness to it, as was shown in court. No witness saw it happen, not one. And so I'll win again, I believe, and that'll be two juries will find that Chris Kyle lied. So I don't think there'll be any doubt about it. And that's what this was all about in the first place, Len. It wasn't about money for me. It was about clearing my name. And now they're going to give me a second opportunity to do it. And so who will doubt it the second time? We already have more witnesses. We've increased our witnesses. People are coming forward who were there that night who know nothing happened. So we're going to have more witnesses. We're going to do even better the second trial than we did the first, and we already won the first one.
Yeah, I hope so. Well, correct me if I'm wrong. Didn't the Navy backtrack on some of the claims that he made about medals that he had as well?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. The Navy came out and officially declared that he lied about his medals. Now, how can you lie about that? anyone that knows the military, see, he claimed to have two silver stars. He only had one. And I'm not denying that the guy wasn't a great shot, that he didn't do his job in Iraq. That's not even part of the conversation. I'm sure he was. But the point is, I was in the military. I'm a Vietnam veteran. And you don't make a mistake if you win a silver star. My God, they have a big presentation. They give you a plaque. It's like getting a college diploma. It goes on your wall. It tells what you did, why you were awarded it. How could anyone think they have two when they only have one? That's absurd. Anyone who's ever served in the military would know how absurd that is. And so he lied about, yeah, then the Navy had to officially come out now and state that Chris Kyle lied about his medals. He did not receive all the medals he claimed to. Even at his funeral, they lied about it.
Okay, well, that's ammunition for your next case. But I would like to discuss a little further this opposition, like you mentioned, from 30 conglomerates.
Yep.
Can you discuss that a bit? Because
what they want to do, they want to be able to defame people and profit from it. See, the reason they're lined up against me, I won on defamation and what they call unjust enrichment, that they enriched themselves via the defamation. They made money. Well, the 33 media conglomerates want that unjust enrichment thrown out so that they're free then to defame anybody, and then they can pay off a little defamation, and all the profits they make, they get to keep, Len. Let me put it in simplistic form. What the 33 media conglomerates, and this is the New York Times, the Washington Post, even NPR is in on it. What they want to do, they don't want to have to fact check. See, it's all about speed in their business. How can we get a story out before the other guy? And they don't give a damn whether the story's true or not. They'll worry about that later down the road. And if you put it in layman's terms so all your listeners will understand, here's what they want, the media. It's equivalent to robbing the bank, Len. It would be like if you went in and robbed the bank, right, and got caught. Okay, they sentence you to 2 years in prison for the actual bank robbery, but then when you get out, you get to keep the money you took.
Yeah, right.
That's in essence what they're saying. Now, if you had the opportunity to go rob the bank and get, say, $1 million, a lot of people, I think, would serve a two-year term and then get out and keep the million, don't you think?
Well, some would.
Sure, but I mean, it don't work that way, though, does it? You're not allowed to keep the money you rob. And that's what the media is asking for permission to do here from the court system. And clearly, it's a corporate decision. Again, corporations in our country favored over individuals. And when I make the statement, we're the fascist states of America, here's your prime example of it. That they want to make it to where corporations can profit by defaming you, and that you're entitled to no money back for them making money by defaming you.
Now, when you said NPR are even in on it, can you describe a little more the in on it? Like,
they all signed up. They're all part of the 33 media conglomerates that hired these big-time Abrams, the big First Amendment lawyer from New York. They came into this court case last June on the appeal, and the two judges kowtowed to them, made a ruling totally in their favor, the corporations, the corporate media. And so they're happy now. It's going back for a new trial, and allegedly I can't get unjust enrichment in the new trial, which is what they set out to do. These corporate media conglomerates who never saw a shred of evidence, never sat through the trial, they came in on the appeal process, and our corrupt judges kowtowed to them and did what they wanted to have done, and it was that simple. So people out there need to understand, if it comes down in this country with the judges between a corporation and an individual, rest assured the corporation is going to prevail pretty well all the time.
Yeah, this is shocking, and I was trying to get your lawyers or whoever's handling, you know, your case to discuss this further because I haven't seen it.
No, they won't. You know, that's not their job at this point. They got to prepare to go to a new trial again, but they have taken the handcuffs off me.
No, I didn't mean it that way.
Talk all you want.
Yeah, but what I meant in just at arm's length, like this is a shocking turn of events that these media conglomerates would join together to do what you're describing here. Is that enable corporations to say anything about, for instance, a candidate or something like that, and they don't have to worry about the...
You have to, the mark, the high water mark for libel is huge anyway. Imagine this. Go back to my case for a moment, Len. How overwhelming must the evidence have been for the jury to side with me overwhelmingly against a dead war veteran and his grieving wife?
Yeah, when you put it like that, right?
How overwhelming. If you were, now we all have sympathy for her. We all feel bad. He shouldn't even have had to go, in my opinion, the whole Iraq war. It was an immoral choice of us invading a country that didn't even do anything to us and overthrowing their government and occupying them. Colonel Prouty'd be turning over in his grave right now. Anyway, that aside, that's how I felt about it. But yet, yeah, and so the media enters this case. They had no dog in the fight, really. It had nothing to do with them. But they saw the precedent that was going to happen here, that I was awarded unjust enrichment for them profiting by lying about me. They made money. Kyle's book made over $40 million, and the movie made like $400 million. You know, and the point is, I was the rocket that propelled it into outer space. When that book broke, the pre-sale was, I think, 2,000 books. When he broke the story on me on Fox News that day, book sales jumped 100,000 in one day. And they're going to say that I wasn't the catalyst that did it, this lying story? Of course it was. And yet they want to deny the mainstream media here in the United States of America. They want the ability, because they're no longer in the news business. They're in the entertainment business. And they've got to get these news stories out and beat the competition. So why do they need to even back check to see if it's correct? They'll worry about that later. They'll get the news out. If it turns out not to be true, well, the person harmed can't sue them for any money, whether they profited from it, because they've gotten the courts of the United States, the Eighth Circuit Court of Appeals, to go along with it.
Well, this is one of the most shocking...
And here's the other thing. They're not talking about it, these 33 media conglomerates, because they don't want the public to know what they're doing. And they control the media. That's why it's not news. That's why nobody, Len, you're the only guy right now in the whole United States that's talking about this, and that's because you got me on the line.
Yeah, it is shocking, and like you mentioned, they're not going to be talking about it at all because it's going against their own interests.
Exactly.
When I spoke to you last time, I just couldn't believe it, and I was trying to look for more information, and that's why I say, trying to go further with it. And like you mentioned, NPR. I mean, so talk about maybe the ramifications in the future. I mean, this is something that...
Well, the ramifications in the future are simple. They'll be able to say anything they want about anyone. And if it turns out to be a lie, the only thing you could sue for is libel. And libel, the bar is very high. You got to really clear. That's like high jumping 7 feet. You got to clear the bar, and which I did, because the jury found for me. You know, and they overthrew that because they claimed the insurance poisoned the jury. So when the jury learned the truth, they got poisoned. It was okay to lie to them in court, but once they learned the truth, oh no, got to have a new trial. I always thought, Len, the courtroom was the place where the truth was supposed to come out. That's how naive I was. I really thought, you know what else they wouldn't allow in my first trial? Wait till you hear this. I've been on blood thinners, Wafrin, since 2002, right? I wasn't allowed to say that because I'm not a doctor. Even though I take them every day to keep my blood thin, and I've been doing it for over almost 15 years now. I know all about it, what it does, what it don't do, why I have to take it. But because I'm not a doctor, all I could say was I was on blood thinning medication. That could be an aspirin dosage a day. But I'm far beyond that. And the point that's important to this case is that had Chris Kyle punched me and my head hit a curb, like he said in one of his three stories, because the story got changed and rewrite 3 times. We proved that in court, too, that the story was rewritten 3 times to make it even better. But he alleged at first that he hit me. I went down and struck my head on the curb and didn't get up. Now, if you're on Wafrin and you were struck at that level and knocked unconscious, that could be fatal. And yet we weren't allowed to bring that out because I'm not a doctor. Well, the second trial, I'm bringing my doctors.
Yeah.
Well, we got it out that I was, and we have photos of me. I have no marks, no nothing.
Yeah, it's funny because I can't believe the opposition to this. I mean, there's some other people that were really upset that how dare you sue them. And they just, if they know the facts, they're outright accessories after the fact.
Yeah, exactly. And the thing is, it's none of their business. This case has nothing to do with NPR. This case has nothing to do with the New York Times. Nothing to do with the Washington Post and all these other 33 major media corporations. It's just they don't want a precedent set that if they libel somebody, that somebody can actually sue them for the profits that they make by libeling somebody. You know? I mean, if you libel a big-name person, that sells, Len. You know that as well as I do. That makes them huge profits. And they don't want to have to admit or have to come forward and say, how much did you make off this? And that's what the court ruled they're allowed to do now.
Yeah. Yeah, well, it's upsetting because, you know, you gave the publisher warning. You said, you know, retract this, claim you've made an error or, you know, whatever. You gave them a way out early in the game.
I gave Chris Kyle the opportunity before he died. We met face to face. And I told Chris Kyle, if you'll walk out there right now and just admit the story about me is not true, I said, I will forgive you and we'll both go on with our lives. Chris Kyle did not have the courage to do that. He did not have the courage to walk out and tell the truth. And that's where it went from there. At that point, when he refused, I gave them the opportunity. That was 4 years ago. That was in 2012. The book came out in January. I met with him in June when I returned from Mexico. And he said we could work it all out if we met face to face. And he looked right at me and said, no, that's not true. I did hit you. And he didn't. So I gave him the opportunity if he'd had the courage, but obviously Kyle didn't have the courage to tell the truth. You know, it does take some courage to be truthful, and he didn't have it. That's why I label him not a hero, because a hero has to have honor, and a liar has no honor. So therefore, Chris Kyle doesn't have honor because he's a liar, and he's lied about a lot of stuff. He lied about his medals. He lied about, what did he say, he shot two people at a convenience store in Texas, and the police let him go. Now, come on. Two homicides take place and the cops just let him scamper off like they'd take care of it for him. And then he lied about being on the dome during Katrina shooting looters. Read the New Yorker magazine story on him. I believe he was, I'm not a doctor again, that's why I couldn't talk about my wayfarer in the courtroom, but to me he's a sociopath or was. He's one of them people that can lie and they believe their lie, you know, and they don't care what their lie does. We've all met them. They're out there in the world, and they do exist. And just because you're a military and you go to war for your country doesn't mean you don't have faults. You're not a perfect person. None of us are.
All right, let's get to your book.
Yep.
Governor, the title.
Crap. Say crap. You won't get in trouble then, Len.
Oh, no, it doesn't matter. It's the shit politicians say.
Yep. Now, let me interject this. I grew up when the great George Carlin, the comedian, about 50 years ago, did an entire routine on the seven words you're not allowed to say.
On TV,
and isn't
yeah.
isn't it amazing, Len, it's 50 years later and we still can't say them?
Yeah.
I mean, I've told people on interviews, you know, I hate to tell you, but I grew up in the inner city, South Minneapolis, right? By the time I reached seventh grade, I believe I had heard every bad word there was and probably had used it by then. So why can't we use these words? They exist. They're in everyday language. But, you know, whatever. But anyway, it's crap politicians say, the craziest stuff ever uttered by our politicians in public.
Now, what made you decide to collect these quotes and make a book?
Well, Tony Lyons, my publisher at Skyhorse, who I attribute a great deal of courage to, he publishes me when the mainstream won't do it. Tony doesn't shy away from controversy. He's a courageous publisher. Tony came up with, and me met, and we talked about the idea about a year and a half ago, and we thought it would be a fun book to put out right in July of 2016, right when they have their national conventions, to really show that these politicians are not what they claim to be, that they make stupid statements, that when you read some, this is a great book because you don't have to read it cover to cover. You can pick it up anywhere in the book and read a quote. And heck, you could read two or three quotes and have talking points for the evening, for a dinner party for the rest of the night. We thought it would be fun to do something on how stupid the quotes are and to show that these people are nothing more than people, that when they get cut, they bleed. They put their pants on one leg at a time as much as they try to make you believe they don't.
Oh, yeah. I mean, there's a quote from that guy in Texas. He says, thank God that George Bush was defending us from freedom. Right.
Yeah, defending us from freedom.
Yeah,
there you go.
Right.
Well,
right.
I love Al Gore's too. A zebra never changes its spots.
Or Bill Clinton saying, I didn't inhale.
Which Al's correct. A zebra doesn't change its spots.
Oh, I know. Yeah, you have chapter one on the founding fathers, on what JFK, the Democrats, the Republicans.
Yeah,
foreign affairs.
Interesting one. Go to the back cover. I don't have my copy. I apologize. I gave it to my mother-in-law the other day. She wanted to read it, and I made the mistake while I had interviews, gave it to her. But read the one by George Bush, George W. Bush, the son, the last quote on the back cover. Bush makes the statement that someday some smart guy's going to come along and find out what exactly happened in this Oval Office. And I read that quote. And I thought, is this a confession? Why would some smart guy need to find out what happened? Is he talking about 9/11 here? Is he talking about the, excuse the pun, the trumped up Iraq war? What exactly did George W. Bush mean when someday some smart person's going to come into the Oval Office and figure out exactly what went on?
Wow. Well, now that people are talking about the 28 pages that have been redacted, how do you feel about that? That it seems
I feel exonerated because I always stated from day one there was more to 9/11 than what they're telling us, and this that the 28 pages clearly show that what was it? 17 of the hijackers were on the Saudi payroll, and that now and yet think about it a moment, Len. They're being paid by the Saudis. They attack us. And then we attack Iraq, who's the Saudis' biggest enemy at the time. Who was really running our country at that time, the Saudis or us? Because we do them the huge favor of invading Iraq and overthrowing Saddam, who was their arch enemy. And Saddam and Iraq had nothing to do with 9/11, but clearly this shows the Saudis did. And if you continued to follow it, if they really would have done a 9/11 report and actually followed through, there's no telling what they would have unearthed. That's how I feel about it. I feel exonerated by the 28 pages. And why did they have to be, if they weren't important, why were they kept from us for over a decade? Why were they withheld for over a decade if it wasn't incriminating to them?
Because it's like Otherwise, they would have released them.
Yeah. They would have released them back when the report was released, and George W. Bush wouldn't have redacted those pages, and Barack Obama wouldn't have came along and re-redacted those pages. What was the problem? Obviously, all of them knew it was a smoking gun.
Yeah, it would lead to investigation, and the timing of it.
Well, and it goes back to the old Woodward Bernstein, follow the money, follow the money.
Well, it's shocking, and, it came out on a Friday, hoping the story would go away, but they could finally say they've redone it. I'm going to have a show on them, and I haven't just had the time to line that up, but it's just, like you say, this is another smoking gun, a tip of the iceberg, that if you start looking, you're going to find some uncomfortable truth.
Oh, yeah, that's why they hate me, because I come out and say things that make them very uncomfortable. And that's why a lot of the public doesn't like me, because I take them out of their comfort zone. You notice, well, look at another example. Do you remember a few months ago when I think it was John McCain discovered it in the defense bill that all the NFL owners were honoring the veterans because they were being paid by the Department of Defense? Did you hear about that one?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, and you notice how they shoveled that under the rug in a day. Boy, that story was out for one day and then got shoveled under the rug. You didn't hear nothing talked about it ever again. And when I heard that, it soured me. I thought, these billionaire owners, not only do they coerce us and our government people into building them billion-dollar stadiums with our money, that they now require to be paid to honor the very veterans that defend this country. How low can you go? How low at the bottom of the barrel can you be to do something like that?
Well, it should be illegal. You're paying taxes to have a defense department, and then they're advertising for you to join, and they're competing, you know, like join the Marines or join the Air Force or join the Army. And these ads, I mean, it's a self-fulfilling,
Well, and not only that, but to honor, then they do these big honor ceremonies at NFL games to the veterans, and they're being paid. As a veteran, that was a slap in the face to me. That was so disrespectful to me as a veteran, to know that people have to be paid to honor us. Now, I understand. I'm a Vietnam veteran. We didn't get honored. People need to go back and face up to that fact, too. Vietnam veterans were not honored when they came home. It took about 20 to 25 years before any type of honor started being bestowed on us. And, you know, and this is another case of shoveling it under the rug. In order for them, for these pro sports teams to honor the veterans, they have to get paid to do it. And then they come back and say, well, now we're going to take the money and give it to the Wounded Veteran Fund. Yeah, only because you got caught and only because it was a public relations nightmare the one day that it was out there. And you notice how the media killed it quick. They killed it quick because what is the NFL? It's the big gold cow, man. You don't mess with the National Football League. Just like that movie. Have you seen that movie, Concussion?
Yeah, I have.
Take a look at that movie and see how your honorable NFL acts. You know, there's a movie, another movie that I think it's, what's-his-name's, one of his greatest performances.
Will Smith?
Yes.
Yeah.
I mean, I think he was better in this even than when he played Ali, and he did a hell of a job with Ali, you know. But I think he was even better in this thing. And look at how that movie got swept under the rug, boy. They didn't give that. And notice how the people avoided truly going to see it because people didn't really want to know, did they, what their great football is doing to the brains of all these players that play it.
And it was the opposition, the fighting back, and the poverty of their defense. That's what really strikes you
here's another thing to look at it for. Another big reason. The greatest basketball player on the planet, LeBron James, right? He's not letting his sons play football. Now, what does that tell you? An athlete the caliber of LeBron James, and you know damn well his kids will probably be hell of a football players if they wanted to be. You know? Yeah, no, but he's not letting them play. Because LeBron's smart enough and loves his children enough that he's not going to introduce them to this game that can destroy their brain.
Yeah, I guess they have to change something, but you would hope that they would be able to, you know, recognize it and change it for the better, you know?
Well, you got to recognize it first, Len, and when you refuse to recognize it like that movie showed, that's what you're dealing with. You know, with these big corporate entities and their big powerful money and the billions of dollars they make, hey, what's a little collateral damage, right? It goes right along with vaccines. They vaccine all of us for the DPT shot and all that, all our kids. Yet there's a small minority group of kids that have an adverse reaction to the DPT shot. I went to Chicago and saw 16 kids who were normal kids. They're now drooling in wheelchairs. And nothing can be done because no doctor will go against the vaccine. Big Pharma, they make huge money off these vaccines. And if there's a little collateral damage, if, you know, one 0.1% of the children end up drooling in wheelchairs. Oh, well, look what all the good it does for all the others. And that's the attitude you have out there. That's what happens when bottom-line corporations take over everything, just like your prisons. It's imperative now for the prisons to be full because they've turned them over to the private sector, and the only way private sector can make profit is by having full prisons. So therefore, they need to keep you putting you in jail so that the prisons will be profitable for the corporations.
I'm shaking my head at that one.
That's the truth.
Yeah.
You know, then that's how they got to run. All the prisons, everyone's screaming the old Republican banter, privatize it, privatize it. Well, there's what privatizing at times can do. See, people fail to understand. The private sector is for profit. The public sector is to provide services. There's a big difference between the two, and Donald Trump will have to learn that. Donald Trump comes from completely the private sector, where it's a money game. Bottom line game. But when you serve as an executive in the government's there to provide services, not to make bottom line profit. And there's a big difference there.
Now, you just mentioned him. What do you think of Donald Trump?
Well, I like Donald. He's a friend of mine. I consider him a friend, but I won't endorse him or vote for him. Number one, because he's now a Republican. He used to be an independent. I don't vote for Democrats or Republicans, no matter who they are, because they then have to kowtow to the party. Look at how Trump is being forced to kowtow to the party. Look at his running mate. He took an established Republican so that he could kowtow to the party when it came time for the election. And then on the flip side, you got Hillary Clinton. You know, I'm all for having a woman president, but does the first one really have to be Hillary? I guess maybe, but to me, there'll be no change because Hillary's a globalist. Hillary's making all these grandiose promises to the Bernie Sanders people to win the election, but you can rest assured once she wins the election, a lot of those promises will disappear very quickly.
Oh, yeah, she's bought and paid for. It's part of the problem, actually. Tell me, who would you
vote
for?
Yeah, very much so.
Who are you supporting? Who are you going to vote for and why?
Well, I came out endorsing Gary Johnson and the Libertarian, but Stein, the Green Party candidate, is also very attractive. Any third party candidate, to me, is far more attractive than the two criminal parties that run this country. The Democrats and the Republicans, as I like to refer to them. And so right now I'm voting for Gary Johnson, but, you know, Dr. Stein is a very qualified person with the Green Party. I wish the Greens and the Libertarians could team up, but they're philosophically too far apart. You know, the Greens are very progressive and socialist, and the Libertarians want the same thing, except without the government. Where the Greens will be more reliant on more government. So that's the dilemma. Plus, I got to tell you, Len, when I won governor of Minnesota, I tried to bring all the independent parties together. I had a big meeting at the governor's residence with the head of the Reform Party, the head of the Green Party, the Libertarians, all of them. And I tried to get us to become one. I said, look, we've got one thing in common. We don't take the dirty money. None of our parties take the PAC money, the special interest money, the lobbyist money. Can't we build from that position and unite? I'll tell you, Len, it was like herding cats. Couldn't be done. So I just threw my hands up in the air after one meeting. I said, this is ridiculous, because every third party has its own agenda, and they want their agenda to be the priority, and they won't consolidate with the other third parties to put forward solidly one candidate to oppose the other two. And see, that's one of the great things, divide and conquer. If you split up all the third party votes, well, then they always end up under 10%, don't they? And that's the problem you deal with. You know, the good thing was when I ran for governor, we were able to solidify the independent and third party people, and 37% of them voted for me, and that's how I won. And for those, the big thing now, Len, is to get Dr. Stein and Gary Johnson, Governor Johnson, in the debates. Because I proved at Labor Day I was polling 10%, which wouldn't even qualify me to get in these debates now. But in 60 days, because I was allowed to debate, I won the governor's 38th governor of Minnesota. So it can be done in 60 days.
Well, it shows the collusion of the media only allowing, you know, bucket of shit and sack of shit. You know, who are you going to vote for?
Exactly. See, the media is part of it, just like when we talked about them entering my court case. The media is owned by the same corporate entities that own the politicians. So the corporations are running this country, which is the definition of fascism. It's the basic definition of fascism. And people better wake up to it. The corporations run the media. They own the media. And they own our elected officials. So every decision is made to benefit them, not us. And then they got that crazy ruling that gave them the same rights that you and I have. Well, if that's the case, I have a very simple question. If corporations have the same rights as people, then why don't corporations pay it at the same tax level people do?
Oh.
You notice they want a different taxing system separate for them. But when it comes to rights, they want all the rights that we have without paying for it.
You know, some of the things that Donald says do strike, you know, with people as fresh and new, and that company, the air conditioning courier and all this. And he says all these corporations that are leaving America, he's going to tax them or put some kind of levy on it. You can't just be an American company and then just do everything offshore.
Yeah, but that's what he does.
No, I know that.
Proof be in the pudding?
Yeah.
I mean,
You're right about that, right?
You know, that's exactly what he's done for 20 years now. All of his clothes are manufactured out of the country. Everything he does is made somewhere else. See, that's what's, you know, that's why
I'm voting for Barry Johnson
or Dr. Stein or anybody but them two parties.
Yeah, well, I'm a Canadian, so I'm off the hook there.
Yeah, but you're going to get the repercussions of it.
I know, but what can I do? It's not like I'm, you know...
You have a radio show, don't you?
You want me to have Gary Johnson on then?
Absolutely.
If you arrange that, I do, no problem.
Call up his people. I'm sure Governor Johnson would be happy to do your shows. Go across the United States, don't they?
Other worldwide. Yeah, they go.
There you go.
Okay, I'm sure
Governor Johnson would enjoy to have a 15, 20-minute, half-hour talk with you.
All right, okay.
Part to even lend as a Canadian. We're asking for Canadian help here. Help us.
Now, speaking about foreign help, I understand that you are going to have a new contract with the RT. Are you going to do a show with them? Can you elaborate then?
Well, hopefully I'll sign it this week. I don't want to pre-do it because I guess they should get the chance to break the news. But considering RT is not one of the 33 media conglomerates here in the United States who's opposing me in this court case, so how could I possibly get hired by any of them? Get my drift?
Yeah.
You know, they have a conflict of interest with me already. Do you think they're going to put me to work? I don't think so. So it's to be honest, Len, ever since the Kyle trial, I lost my television show Conspiracy Theory because of it. I couldn't get hired for 2 years. No one would touch me. I finally got hired by Aura, and that's only because the person that owns the company is from Mexico. And through Aura now, I'm being hired by Russian television. Now, how ironic is that the Russians will give me a chance to speak freely and my own United States media will not? It's astounding to me, having lived through the entire Cold War, that it's the Russians that are giving me freedom of speech right now. And let me say this for a moment. I had a mother and father who are both World War II veterans. Not too many people can state that their mother was a World War II veteran, but I can. My mom was a nurse in North Africa, which predated Normandy. So she was in on the war before Normandy even happened. And my father had 6 bronze battle stars finishing in Berlin. I think he had North Africa, Normandy, Battle of the Bulge, Remagen Bridge, Anzio, and Berlin, I think, were his battle stars. And my father, before he died, used to talk to me glowingly about the Russians he met in Berlin when they got there. right? They were our allies. They were with us. I, for the life of me, couldn't understand how that war hadn't even finished yet, and Russia became our mortal enemy. And then I read a book on Alan Dulles, and it came clear to me this last year. It's because Wall Street was running our country then, too. And who's the biggest fear of Wall Street? It isn't Nazis. It isn't right-wing anything. The biggest fear of Wall Street is socialism, which is what Russia was embracing with the communist rule. So that was the reason that they immediately became our enemy after World War II, was because Wall Street fears socialism. Why do you think they fear Bernie Sanders? That's their biggest fear, and Alan Dulles and them guys were running the country back then. And so that's how Russia became our enemy. Well, to shorten this story up, that's always bothered me. And I'm at the point now in my life, I'm 65 years old now, so I have to pick and choose what type of cause or what legacy I want to finish with. And the reason I'm going to sign with Russian television is because I want to do what little I can, whatever small part I might be able to play in making the United States and Russia friends. I have a question, Len. Maybe you can answer it for me. You're Canadian. Why, what has Putin and Russia done since turning capitalist that has our anger so bad? Why is the United States creating another Cold War with Russia? What have they done, Len? Please explain it to me. What have they done?
I'm not able to explain that.
I can't either. Now, they invaded that one area because there were a lot of Russians in there. So there was a conflict of interest. You had a huge Russian population, and their military was already there, and they put more in there. But then, look, how can we call that aggression after what we did in Iraq?
Oh, I know. And there's
we
more
invaded
to that story.
And overthrew a country that didn't do anything to us, and yet we're angry at Russia's aggression? And then
yeah,
when you look at it,
Syria and Libya.
Well, Russia has two military bases outside of Russia. The United States has, I think, 178 outside the United States. And who's the aggressor? Common sense would tell you the U.S. is.
Yeah, and they're defending their base, their port base in the Crimea. So there's more to this story. And then the whole Ukrainian money behind overthrowing that whole situation. There's a whole other story there.
Exactly. And yet they're now our mortal enemy. I heard the other day Barney Frank called Putin a thug. Now, how would we react if a Russian diplomat called our president a thug? I mean, where's the respect here? You know, a little bit. And why is Putin a thug? I met him last December, and I found him pretty decent, to be blunt. He at least called me governor. That's more than the two federal judges did here in my own country. Putin came up to me and shook my hand and called me governor. The two federal judges wrote a 12 or 13 page brief. And in the entire brief, never even referred to me as governor. I was Ventura. So I'd like to know where respect is here. When the Russians give me more respect, the 38th governor of Minnesota, than what our federal judges do? Anybody see something wrong with that picture?
Well, there's a lot wrong, and you're one of the people who are talking about it, pointing it out. You know, that's why.
And I get in trouble for it, Len. I'll tell you what. You know, it's interesting because people always tell you they want to know the truth. I don't really think they do. I think that the truth takes people out of their comfort zone. I think people like being in a nice, secure little comfort zone, and anything that's said that disrupts that comfort zone, they don't like it. So I really don't believe people really do want to know the truth.
Well, maybe like the old quote says, they can't handle the truth, because I want to know the truth. But some people, even when you're talking about the Kennedy assassination or other things, people, you know, well, why would the government do this? You know, they're so far out of the loop of knowledge that they have no inkling of what's going on.
Exactly. That's called living in their comfort zones.
Yeah.
They don't want anything to disturb their little comfort zone. And that's why Jesse Ventura becomes unpopular, because I say things that reflect and disturb the comfort zone and make them think about things they don't want to think about that are real, but they prefer not to think about them. You know, if you don't think about something, then maybe it goes away, you think? Not really, but you might think it does.
Well, speaking about these elections and Russia and all and everything, can you elaborate a little further about why you didn't run? You mentioned that you were possibly going to be...
Yeah, this was the year to do it, Len, and I thought hard about it. The Libertarians invited me twice to come to their convention, but I knew Governor Johnson and Governor Weld wanted that the opportunity greatly, and I sat down with my wife, and I'll tell you exactly what it was. First of all, I'm 65, and I run to win. So that means I'd have to do it till at least age 70, okay? And I don't want to hear that Trump's older than me and so is Hillary. That's their business. I'm speaking on my behalf. At 65, I would have had to do it till age 70. I was up for running. I was up for debating these people. I'd love to do it, but I couldn't go all in if I won. And you got to be prepared 100% to go all in. And I just couldn't bring myself to the 100%. I like my life in Mexico too much. I would personally rather be surfing in the winter than sitting in the White House. And with those doubts in my mind, I didn't feel it was fair to me, my family, or to anyone that would vote for me. If I wasn't in 100%, you shouldn't do it. And I couldn't bring myself to be in 100% to do the job, you know. And so that's why I chose not to go to the Libertarian Convention. And they went ahead and nominated Governor Johnson, whom I would be extremely happy if he became the next president.
Well, I think you made the right choice.
I do, too, because it's that simple. You have to be motivated. I was motivated. I wanted to take him on. I'd love to be able to run, do the debates, win, and then let somebody else go do it. But unfortunately, it doesn't work that way. And I just couldn't bring myself to commit myself till age 70 minimum. You know, you, as you get older, you start valuing your time more.
Yeah.
And I just couldn't. Those jobs are 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, unless you're George W. Bush. Then, of course, you go on vacation every other day. But him aside, you know, those jobs, if you're going to do them right, I know from being governor, it's a 24/7 job. You don't get a day off, and the president's got to be even 10 times worse than being a governor. And I couldn't bring myself to do it.
Now, you mentioned something in another interview that I wasn't aware of. Maybe you can elaborate on this point. You mentioned something to the effect that if Gary Johnson was to win a certain percentage of the vote, and I'll just make up a number like 25%, it would leave the other two candidates not having enough to actually win the Electoral College.
Here's how it works, Len. It doesn't have nothing to do with the percentage that Governor Johnson would win, because president's the only election in America where you can get the most votes and lose. Case in point, Al Gore in 2000. Al Gore got 500,000 more votes than George Bush did, yet he lost because of the Electoral College. No, here's the scenario. If Governor Johnson wins his home state of New Mexico and wins those electoral votes there, if he could sneak out and maybe win one or two other states, and then Hillary and Trump split the rest of the electoral states, if nobody reaches that magic number of 270 or whatever the hell it is, we got no president. Because, you know, any other election, be it mayor, governor, Congress, or Senate, if you get the most votes, you win. But in president, it's an elitist system with these electoral college votes. That's the fix. You have to get so many of them to be president. I'm hoping Gary Johnson can do well enough and take enough electoral votes that Trump or Clinton can't reach that magic 270 number. And if that happens, then the Congress will decide who the next president is, and that ought to be interesting.
Oh, heaven help us, right?
But that's what I hope. You know why I hope it happens? I hope then it'll motivate this country to move forward and eliminate the Electoral College, which should have been done a long time ago. The Electoral College was put into place, one of the major reasons was because they didn't have the ability to count the votes in Washington. So delegates had to ride on horseback to Washington to cast their state delegated votes and elect the president. Well, my answer to that is, when's the last time anybody went to Washington on horseback? A long time ago. So let's get rid of this thing, this antiquated, elitist BS system called the Electoral College, and make it like any other election. If you get the most votes, you win. Imagine how that could have changed the world. Al Gore got 500,000 more votes. Just think, there would have probably never been a war in Iraq, or maybe 9/11 wouldn't even have happened.
Yeah, the what ifs, but he shouldn't have buckled under.
By changing the Electoral College, then you get the guy who actually won the election.
Yeah, I still think he was too weak and backed down. He should have stuck to his guns further, but I guess for the party, for being a patriotic duty, he just folded.
I don't know. That you'd have to ask him, but the point is he wouldn't even have to worry about it if it had been a popular vote, would he?
Well, that's the
thing. See, that's why the big thing is, let's get rid of the Electoral College, and that's what I'm hoping the 2016 elections can accomplish. Because if they can't elect a president, then maybe they'll wake up, the people, and demand that, you know, this isn't any good. Let's make it a popular vote the way any other election is.
Well, Governor Ventura, it's been a pleasure to speak to you. We've been trying
to discuss. It always is, Len. Thank you. Sorry about the other day. We had a miscommunication with Jen and myself.
That's okay. No problem. I'm glad that you could reschedule.
Oh, yeah. No problem with that. Always got time for you, Len.
Oh, well, thank you so much for saying that. It's a pleasure to speak to you and promote your latest book, The Shit Politicians Say. And I think maybe if we wrap up here, I could maybe have you give a quote on reincarnation. That might be one of my favorite quotes out of this book.
Yeah, me give a quote on my definition on reincarnation. That was only because Playboy asked me that. They said if you could be reincarnated as anything. And I was in a funny mood that day, and I didn't realize that it would be taken out of context, out of Playboy magazine, and put on the front page. But I just made the statement having fun. I said, if I could be reincarnated as anything, I'd like to be a Double D38 bra.
What do you mean out of context?
the point being is that
if you take
quotes from Playboy and put them on the front page of a newspaper, that's like taking the pictures from Playboy and putting them on the front page of the newspaper. If it had only been read by Playboy readers, there'd have been no negative whatsoever to it. But the problem was they took it away from Playboy and they made it mainstream. And that was my mistake. I was naive. I didn't realize that the media would do things like that, but they certainly do, just as they jump into court cases that are none of their business, really.
Well, I smiled when I read that, and I think everybody, reasonable person, will recognize humor, which you don't. I mean, look at the chapter
not
on
really.
George Bush.
Wait a minute. They don't recognize humor, because look when Donald Trump said that stuff about the Russians finding Hillary's email. I bursted out laughing right away. I said, that is funny. Because Trump was making a joke. He was saying, well, we can't find these emails. The Russians apparently hacked into the Democratic emails of the Democratic Party. Well, let's go to them. They could probably find the emails. And I took it as a joke completely. And yet, the media got, they were accusing Trump of making deals and committing treason to Russia. See, the problem is, it's like when I was governor, whenever I'd say a joke, I got to where I would, at the end, I would turn to the press and say, that's a joke, joke, joke. And I would say it three times so that the press was clear that I was not being serious. And it requires that. Better yet, in those jobs, you can't joke at all.
Yeah, that's part of the problem.
But I found Trump's comments, I started laughing. I said, that's funny. He's going to say, let the Russians find them. Apparently we can't.
Well, I never believed it was the Russians ever. I thought, my first thought was, it's an insider leaked this, right?
Sure it is. Yeah. Absolutely it was. I don't think the Russians that see what you have there with the emails. And then I got to run, Len. What you've got there is the classic example of killing the messenger, not the message. The message is those emails were written. Bernie Sanders was undercut by the very Democratic Party that tells us of honesty. There's your dishonesty right there. Not only is Hillary part of the dishonest party, but here you've got a party that dishonestly put her in as their nominee by doing things to Bernie Sanders under the table. That's what should be the story, not who discovered it. But that's what they love to do. They kill the messenger, not the message. And that's what you have clearly here. Bill Maher and all those people on TV won't talk about the message itself and how the Democrats actually did this to Bernie. How could we trust them with anything else? And yet, it's all about, let's find someone we can blame, the Russians. Well, the Russians hacked in and got it. They have no proof of that right now. That's all BS. They're just throwing it out there, to distract everyone with a red herring. Anyway, I'm done for today, Len. Have a good one. We'll talk again.
Thank you very much. Good night.
Bye-bye.
Black Op Radio is pleased to announce a direct download section. That's right. Now you can purchase all archive shows and specialty packages such as the John Armstrong interview, Doug Horn, Jim Douglas, Jim DiGenio, and more. So instead of having to wait with regular mail, you can get shows you want in minutes directly to your computer. Check out the direct download section at blackopradio.com.
Black Op Radio presents Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty, the DVD Complete Collection. Finally, the DVD set you've been waiting for is available. Over 15 hours with Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty. Over 15 hours. Interviews with Len Osanek, John Judge, David Ratcliffe, and more. This is a one-of-a-kind set. These interviews feature Fletcher Prouty having candid conversations regarding his 23 years in the military, but specifically 9 years in the Pentagon from 1955 to 1964. His inside knowledge is invaluable to researchers of this era of American and world history. These are the revelations you've been waiting for. Over 15 hours with Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty, the complete DVD collection. Available at the Colonel Prouty reference site, www.prouty.org, and blackopradio.com. It's a political rally, a free speech zone, a town hall meeting. It's an interrogation at NSA headquarters. Now, it's time to make a statement. Time to represent. Time to let them know who you are. That you're part of the Black Op. With a brand new Black Op Radio t-shirt. Comes in all sizes. Wear it loud and proud. Join the Black Op today. www.blackopradio.com. If you believe there's more to the JFK assassination and the mystery surrounding the CIA and its covert operations, you're not alone. Meet the man Oliver Stone called X in the epic motion picture JFK. Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty comes forward with never-before-seen or heard documentation and information about JFK, the Vietnam War, the CIA, and more on a brand new CD-ROM. The collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty is an incredible offer not to be missed. For a limited time only, find the answers surrounding these issues and more with the collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty. Or visit the Colonel Prouty reference site on the World Wide Web, the collected works of Colonel L. Fletcher Prouty.